Snow White. Once there was a young princess who wasn't at all unpleasant to look at and had a temperament that many found to be more pleasant than most other people's. Her nickname was Snow White, indicative of the discriminatory notions of associating pleasant or attractive qualities with light and unpleasant or unattractive qualities with darkness. Thus, at an early age, Snow White was unwitting if fortunate target for this type of colorist thinking. When Snow White was quite young, her mother was suddenly stricken ill, grew more advanced in non-health, and finally was rendered non-viable. Her father, the king, cried for what can be considered a healthy period of time, then asked another woman to be his queen. Snow White did her best to please her new mother of step, but a cold distance remained between them. The queen's prized possession was a magic mirror that would never answer truthfully any question asked it. Now years of social conditioning in a male hierarchical dictatorship had left the queen very insecure about her own self-worth. Physical beauty was the one standard she cared about now, and she defined herself solely in regard to her personal appearance. So every morning the queen would ask her mirror, "Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all?" Her mirror would answer, "For all its worth, oh my queen, your beauty is the fairest to be seen." That dialogue went on regularly until once, when the queen was having a bad hair day and was desperately in need of support, she asked the usual question and the mirror answered, "Alas, if worth be based on beauty, Snow White has surpassed you, cutie." At this, the queen grieved into rage. The chance to work with Snow White to form a strong bond of sisterhood had long passed. Instead, the queen indulged in an adopted masculine power trip and ordered the royal wood person to take Snow White into the forest and kill her. And possibly to impress the males in the royal court, she barbarously ordered that the girl's heart to be cut out and brought back to her. The wood person sadly agreed to these orders and led the girl, who was now actually a young woman, into the middle of the forest. But his connections to the earth and seasons had made him a kind soul, and he couldn't bear to harm the girl. He told Snow White of the oppressive and ancestrally order of the queen and told her to run as deeply as she could into the forest. The frightened Snow White did as she was told. The wood person, fearing the queen's wrath but unwilling to take another life, merely to indulge her vanity, went into town and had the candle maker concoct a heart of marpison. When he presented this queen, she hungrily devoured the heart in a sickening display of pseudo-cannibalism. Meanwhile, Snow White ran deep into the woods. Just when she thought she had fled as far as she could from civilization and its unhealthy influences, she stumbled upon a cottage. Inside, she saw seven tiny beds set in a row in all unmade. She also saw seven sets of dishes piled high in the sink and seven barkalungers in front of the seven remote control TVs. She surmised that the cottage belonged to either seven little men or one sleepy numerologist. The beds looked so inviting that the tired youngster curled up on one and immediately fell asleep. When she awoke several hours later, she saw the faces of seven bearded, vertically challenged men surrounding the bed. She sat up with a start and gasped. One of the men said, "You see that? Just like a flight of woman, resting peacefully on 1 minute, up and screaming the nest." "I agree," said another. "She will disrupt our strong bond of brotherhood and create competition among us for her affections. I say we throw her in the river in a sack full of rocks." "I agree, we should get rid of her, said the third. "But why degrade the ecology? Let's just feed her to the bear or something and let her become part of the food chain." Here. Sound thinking, brother. When Snow White finally regained her senses, she begged, "Please don't kill me. I meant no harm by sleeping on your bed. I thought no one would ever notice." "All you see," said one of the men, "female preoccupations are already surfacing. She's complaining that we don't make our beds. Kill her, kill her." "Please no," she cried. "I have traveled so deep into these woods because my mother of step, the queen, ordered me killed. See that? Internal some female vindictiveness. Don't try and play the victim with us, kid. Quiet, boomed one of the men, who had flaming red hair and a non-human animal skin on his head. Snow White quickly realized that he was their leader and that her fate rested in his hands. Explain yourself, what's your name and why are you here, really, why you came here? My name is Snow White, he began, and I've already told you my mother of step, the queen, ordered a wood person to take me in the forest and kill me. But he took pity and told me to run away into the woods as far as I could. Just like a woman, grumbled one of the men under his breath. Get a man to do her dirty work. The leader held up his hands for silence. He said, well, Snow White, if that's your story, I guess we will have to believe you. Snow White was beginning to resent her treatment, but tried not to let it show. And who are you guys, anyway? We are known as Seven Towering Giants, said the leader. Snow White's suppression of giggle didn't go unnoticed. The leader continued, we are towering in spirit, and so we are giants among the men of our forest. We used to earn our living by digging in our mines, but we decided to such a rape of the planet was immoral and short-sighted. Besides, the bottom fell out of the metals market. So now we are dedicated stewards of the earth and we live here in harmony with nature. To make ends meet, we also conduct retreats for men who need to get in touch with their primitive masculine identities. So what does that involve, asked Snow White, aside from drinking milk straight from the carton? Your sarcasm is ill-advised, warned the leader of the Seven Towering Giants. My fellow giants want to get rid of your corrupting feminine presence, and I might not able to stop them. Understand? My man, we must speak our hearts openly and honestly. Let us adjourn to the Sweet Lodge. Seven little men screamed at the front door, whooping and stripping of their clothes. Snow White didn't know what to do while waiting, for fear of stepping on anything that might be scurrying about amid the debris on the floor. She stayed on the bed, although she didn't manage to make it without ever stepping off. Snow White heard drumming and shouts, and soon after, the seven towering giants came back into the cottage. They didn't smell as bad as she thought they would, and thankfully, they all wore loin clothes. Oh, look what she's done to my bed. I want her out of here. I want to change my vote. Calm down, brother, said the leader. Don't you see, this is just what we were talking about, contrast. We can better measure our progress as true men if there is a female around for comparison. The men grumbled among themselves about the wisdom of this decision. But Snow White had had enough. I resent being kept around like an object, just a yardstick for egos and penises. Fair enough, the leader said. You are free to make your way back through the woods. Give our regards to the queen. Well, I guess I can stall until I figure out new plans, she said. Very well, said the leader. But we have a few ground rules. No dusting, no straightening up, and no rising out underwear in the sink. And no peeking in the sweet lodge. And stay away from our drums. Meanwhile, back at the castle, the queen rejoiced at the thought that her rival in beauty had been eliminated. She puttered around and bodied reading glamour and elf, and indulged herself with the three whole pieces of chocolate without purging. Later, she confidently strolled up to her magic mirror and asked her same sad question. Mirror, mirror on the wall, who is the fairest one of all? The mirror replied, your weight is perfect for your shape and height, but for sheer oomph, you can't beat Snow White. At this news, the queen clenched her fist and screamed at the top of her lungs. For years, her insecurities had been eating away at her until now. Then they turned her into someone who was morally out of the mainstream. With cunning and malice, she began to devise a plan to ensure the non-viability of her daughter of step. A few days later, Snow White, to be sure she didn't touch or rearrange anything, was meditating on the floor in the middle of the cottage. Suddenly, there was a knock on the door. Snow White opened the door to find a chronologically gifted woman with a basket in her hand. By the look of her clothes, she was apparently unfettered by the confines of regular employment. Help a woman of unreliable income, dearie, she said, and buy one of my apples. Snow White thought for a moment. In protest against agribusiness conglomerates, she had a personal rule against buying from the middle persons. But her heart went out to the economically marginalized woman, so she said yes. What Snow White didn't know was that this was really the queen in disguise, and that the apple had been chemically and genetically altered so that whoever bit it would sleep forever. When Snow White handed over the money for the apple, you would have expected the queen to be gleeful that her plan was for revenge was working. Instead, as she looked at Snow White's fine complexion and slim taut body, she felt alternating waves of envy and self-revulsion. Finally, she burst into tears. Why, whatever, what's the matter? Asked Snow White. You are so young and beautiful, sobbed the disguised queen. And I am horrible to look at and getting worse. You shouldn't say that. After all, beauty comes from inside a person. I've been telling myself that for years, said the queen. And I still don't believe it. How do you stay in such perfect shape? Well, I meditate, work out in step aerobics 3 hours a day, and eat only half portions of anything placed in front of me. Would you like to me show you? Oh, yes, yes, please, said the queen. Once they start out with 30 minutes of simple hatha yoga meditation, then worked out the step for another hour as they relaxed afterward. Snow White cut her apple in half and gave a piece to the queen. Without thinking, the queen bit into it, and both of them fell into a deep sleep. Later that day, the seven towering giants returned from a retreat in the woods, elaborately decked out in animal skins, feathers, and moat. With them, there was a prince from a nearby kingdom who had come on this male retreat to find a cure for his impotence, or as he preferred to call it, his involuntary suspension from phallocentric activity. They were all laughing and high-fiving until they saw the bodies and stopped short. What has happened? Asked the prince. Apparently, our house guest and this other woman got into some sort of catfight and killed each other, surmised one giant. If they thought that by doing this, they could make us slaves to our weaker emotions, they are wrong, fumed another. Well, as long as we have to dispose of them, let's practice one of those fucking funerals we have read about. You know, said the prince, this might sound a little sick, but I trust you guys. I found that younger one attractive. Extremely attractive. Would you fellow mind waiting outside while I... Stop right there, said the leader of the giants. Those half-eaten apple pieces, that filthy custom, this has other earmarks of some sort of maggot spell. They are not really dead at all. Well, sighed the prince, that makes me feel better. So could you guys take five and let me hold it, prince, said the leader. Does Snow White make you feel like a man again? She certainly does. Now could you guys... Don't touch her, you will break the spell. The leader thought for a minute and said, My brothers, I see certain economic possibilities arising from this. If we kept Snow White around here in the state, we could advertise our retreats as impotency therapy. The giants nodded in agreement with this idea, but the prince interrupted. But what about me? I've already paid for my retreat. Why don't I get to take the cure? No dice, prince, said the leader. You can look, but don't touch. Otherwise, you will break the spell. Tell you what, though. You can have the other one if you want. I don't want to sound classist, said the prince, but she is not high enough caliber for me. That's pretty big talk from a man shooting blanks, said one of the giants. And everybody but the prince laughed. The leader said, Come on, brothers, let's lift these two off the floor and decide how we can best display them. It took three giants for each female, but they managed to get both bodies aloft. As soon as they did, however, the pieces of poisoned apple fell from the mouth of Snow White and the queen, and they awoke from the spell. What do you think you are doing? Put us down, they shouted. The giants were so startled, they almost dropped the woman to the floor. "That was the most sickening thing that I ever heard," shouted the queen, "offering us like a piece of property." "And you," said the Snow White to the prince, "trying to make it with a girl in a coma? Yuck." "Hey, don't blame me," said the prince. It's a medical condition." The leader of the giants said, "Don't start tossing blame around. You both broke into our property in the first place. I can call the police." "Don't try it, Napoleon," said the queen. "This forest is property of the crown. You are the ones who are trespassing." This rejoined caused quite a stir, but not as big a commotion as when the queen warned. "And another thing, while we were immobile and you all blathered in your sexist way, I had a personal awakening. From now on, I'm going to dedicate my life to healing the rift between women's souls and their bodies. I am going to teach women to accept their natural body image and become whole again. Snow White and I are going to build a women's spa and conference center on this very spot where we can hold retreats, cause cuckoos and ovariums for the sisters of the world." There was much shooting and name calling, but the queen eventually had her way. Before the seven towering giants could be reached from their home, though, they packed up their sweet lodge and moved deeper into the woods. The prince stayed on the spa as a cute but harmless tennis pro, and Snow White and the queen became good friends and earned worldwide fame for their contributions to sisterhood. The giants were never heard from again, save for little muddy footprints that were sometimes found in the morning outside the windows of Spa's locker room.